now you will find out what this has been about and what it is for the rest. Thank you, Monica, for introducing this. Just a word of introduction about what this is about. This has been a workshop based on this place and on the main theme coming from this place, which is disobedience. So some of them came with an idea, and some of them didn't, and just spent a year and had like 5 days to explore it. Our job with Mariana, which I would like to take this opportunity to thank, because she has been a great help organizing this, has been to basically give them advice on how to write a script. And it's been really interesting to be part this week because we've had different kind of speakers and different points of view on dramaturgy and storytelling. Ours was more film-oriented, script-oriented, but it's been great to also dwell on the other things that were said, especially the opening lecture, which has been very inspirational. So basically, the format is, we have 16 participants, so that's most of the program. There's an order, they're going to come up here, 5 minutes, just telling you about their background, their story, the why, basically. And then we'll open for questions for like 2 minutes, so I would really appreciate if you guys have any questions to just ask them. This is not, this thing is derived from another workshop that I organized. It's called European Short Pitch, and this is a spin-off, so it's a smaller version. So the idea is not to put too much pressure. I don't want the participants to feel too much stressed, and I don't want you guys asking questions to feel like harsh or anything. It's more like sort of a Q&A, like questions about something you didn't understand, or like a genuine question you might have about what was said. So feel free just to, you know, raise your hands and ask a question. This is not a test, it's more like, perhaps I say a word about what pitching is, for those of you who don't know what that is. It's like this sort of a, let's say, American, North American technique of how to put in a nutshell a story, especially for the feature films. You know, you can't just like tell the whole story, you have to condense it somehow. And there are clues, there are ways of doing this.
But it's been a pleasure to take part in this training. So today I'm going to present to you my idea for a short fiction film called Disconnect Your Mind. It's based on a character, on a real character, who I met during research for a feature documentary film that I've been developing with my co-director and scriptwriter, Diana Ivanova. The story of the film portrays a character called Amel, aka Mission Rice. Amel is a spoken word Cuban artist. And without like me explaining to you, I'd like to show you a short clip that we shot of Amel performed this January in Havana. And it will give you an idea of the style he uses and most of the attention to what he's talking about. So it's just one minute.
About mainly about black heritage, about freedom of expression, about being oppressed,
lyrics, but actually what you don't see in this footage is that Amel has a huge secret. In the past years, he developed a huge sleeping disorder and psychosis. He believes that somebody planted a microchip in his brain. And his paranoia goes as far as to include his whole family. He thinks that his mother was the person who actually sold him to this government program when he was younger. And Amel is really trying to find out if this is happening or not. So the film is going to touch upon two things. On one hand is his creative inspiration, the topics that he's discussing, you know, an intimate portrait of his creative process on one hand, and on the other hand it's going to be like an investigation of he's trying to find out if his psychosis is a real fact or not. He also has a nervous stick. He keeps scratching the back of his head like this. And at the end of the film, we're not going to have a very definite, like, in-your-face solution to his question. It's more like going to be him discovering other people with the same kind of thing after a series of investigations and meeting different people. And also, Amel, at the end of the film, is going to create a song called Disconnect Your Mind, which is going to become very popular in Cuba and in the rest of the world. In terms of visual style, I've been thinking to combine also two styles. So one is going to be this very intimate portrait of his creative process, and the other one is going to be a documentary style, very day kind of shoot, which is going to show him trying to research his past. My core motivation for this project is to capture that one intimate story, which is part of the present change in Cuba. So what's happening, you all know, I don't need to go into details, but what's happening is that the country is opening up, both, you know, legislatively, in terms of communications. There is now internet for the first time, which reduces the level of censorship. So different people are allowed to, in various aspects, to, you know, share opinions and criticize the system. And what's happening, I think, in Cuba is that there's this clash of utopias at the moment. So the country's been locked out for almost 80 years, so it's a very interesting process for me. And I think the story with Amel is a symbolic clash, the representation of this clash. So on one hand we have his search for new truth, while he's emotionally and disobediently battling the system. And on the other side, for him, this is also not just emotional, but also physical. So the story is structured in this difficult way. And my aim is, I was thinking about it, my aim is when telling people the story is to make them think about their own freedoms and how they use them in their everyday life. So just make it a little self-reflective. And as I said, my background in political science helps me tell the story a lot, and also my personal experience, because in my life I've lived through a similar political change in my country, Bulgaria, from a authoritarian to what's now called a democratic regime. So I think that I have a good insight to tell the story. So I think that's about it. Thank you very much.
Do we have questions from the audience?
Hello, Michael. Nice to meet you. I'm a participant here at the Film Screen Writing Camp. I studied in England film studies and screenwriting. Right now I'm continuing my studies more like in an advertising way. And I came here because I wanted to develop this very interesting story. The idea came from a friend of mine. He works in a newspaper, and he recently changed his job, and I had the opportunity to speak with him. And the interesting thing is that this newspaper is owned by one person who is also owning about 80% of media in Bulgaria, so you can say that he is a media oligarch. And this friend of mine revealed to me how usually the media operates in Bulgaria. He revealed to me how, for example, they usually follow orders in developing stories, how they develop stories to take the attention off of something very important going on, and basically how the media exists not to serve people, but to serve very few specific interests within the country. So my story follows this one young guy who receives one day a tremendous opportunity. His boss dies, and he's supposed to do the TV talk show instead of him. And he understands that his boss has been doing for a very long time an investigation about a very high government official. And the young guy wants to tell that story. But he understands that it's extremely difficult to tell the truth in a country like Bulgaria. It's very difficult because there are people who are ready to do everything to silence people who want to say the truth. There are threats, there are compromises, there are financial interests that actually obscure us from telling the truth in itself. And as this great passage that I have chosen to say here, it is actually the truth that sets people free. And in that case, in my story, the young person is incapable actually of telling the whole story. He actually has to destroy the files. But in the end, he understands that his boss died not because he was killed, but because he actually has committed suicide. He couldn't bear the truth. And our character begins his journey in the beginning as a very submissive, very opportunistic guy who wants basically to be successful. But he understands that he cannot save himself if he doesn't save the truth. And he decides to tell the truth of how his boss died, that it was actually lying and suppressing the truth that actually got him in the end. So that's my story. And I believe it's extremely important for a country which for the past 10 years has been going only down in the rankings of international associations like Reporters Without Borders. Our country, this thing called the truth, it's considered to be something that doesn't exist. So this is why our freedoms are also very obscure. I believe that my story is extremely important in times like this, because we have to rethink our relationship with the truth in order to feel ourselves free. Thank you.
Performances, more like dance, puppetry, visual.
And this is actually my, I think, first short movie workshop and very first script. So now I want that we all play some little game, but it will happen in your mind. You don't have to talk with me. So let's choose. You have yes answer and you have a no answer. Which one you choose? Like today, what? You don't have to search for your purpose. It's just yes or no. Which one? You decide.
Yes.
Yeah.
No.
Oh.
You can keep it in your head. You just have it in your mind. So my script has the title The No Man. And I created like two words. It's one is the yes, it's yes girl, and the no man. So it's actually, it's a girl, a woman, Lucy, and she's really playful and looking for adventures. And then it's the no man. The no man, like, he answered like, no, he's not doing really something in the script. Actually, he's lying all the time in the bed. So, and this is the main conflict, how to survive in this kind of relationships. And then they are in love, of course, it's a love story. So, what Yes is doing? She's trying to move this snowman, like in the suggestions, and she, in one scene, she's dancing for him, but she doesn't, he doesn't really care. And what is the element in this movie that it's really like kind of climax and important, it's that no man really likes her hair. It's the, I think it's the last thing that he kind of really likes. She has like a really long, blonde, softly curly hair. So in one point she decided that she will cut this hair. And she does this in front of him, standing on the bed, of course, he's lying. So this is when she cuts his, her hair, she decided to leave. And she is telling this to him, he doesn't really care. So she's leaving. She left. She leaves. She leaves. So this is the basic of the story. And then I, you know, everything has some kind of reason. So also the no man has a reason why he's the no man. And he wasn't like this like for all his life. And he became a no man because his friend died when they were climbing the mountains. And this is a really terrible situation because when you are climbing, you have to protect each other. So after that, he packed all the sport things and all the climbing things in the box, and he became a nomad, like really isolated. He doesn't want that Lucy will help him. So in the end, that Lucy lives, it's really the good thing for him, because he needs time, and Lucy is not the right person to help him. And in the end, he opened this box with the very things and sports, and Lucy box right next to him. So I think that sometimes we can really make each other unhappy or miserable. So it's in the way it's better just to leave or to make some distance in order to make each other happy. And in this way, this story is actually
studies of the emotions and feelings, how they were studied in France in the 19th century,
And then actually I realized this morning the story brings that all back to that. So the name of my story is Lead Me Zeus. Zeus as being the Greek god of thunder and lightning. It's about Bistra, a young Bulgarian woman. She's about 35 years old. She lives in Sofia. And she's stuck in a hopeless job. And she's picking up the film. She's just at the another hopeless relationship has just ended. And she concludes that my life is totally meaningless. And she makes the decision to take her own life by starving herself to death. And so she goes to takes a car and goes to the closed down school for young disobedience, where she was interned when she was about 17. And she goes there to spend the last days and basically waste away and fade away and wilt like a flower up in her own room. And there, on the premises, she meets Ivan, who's a 75-year-old man. He's the friendly caretaker, who used to work at the school, he still lives on the premises. And so she meets him, and through patient philosophical discussion, he manages to, he makes her realize that she's actually been, that she's been denying her pain, and not as she thought, actually, you know. Been thinking about it, but she hasn't been getting into it and accepting it and going to it. So he makes her realize that she's been denying it and finally persuades her to choose life over death. So as you can imagine, this is a bit of a psychological drama. Contains a little bit of humor as well, that will come out in the dialogue. And I think the heart of the story is it's about daring to feel pain. And why Lead Me Zeus? Because Lead Me Zeus, that's the beginning of a kind of a mantra or a kind of a prayer that the Stoic says, that Lead Me Zeus, lead me destiny. So she kind of thought her destiny was to have a brave death and face death, you know, rationally with reason and see. So that's why she chose starving to death and not just a quick slip of the wrist and, or jumping off a cliff or something. And yeah, that's basically it.
Switch to the short film, and that's why I'm here. We have I would like us to sympathize with the older couple, because we know that the young man is a delinquent kind of, and he may be capable of doing something to them. But then, after revealing the characters, we know he's the good guy, and they are not the bad guys, but they are psychopathic guys, and they might be capable of doing something to him, maybe to hurt him, to ruin his plans. So we are afraid. We are afraid of that. And I would like to do some humor, because it might sound like, you know, there are psychopaths and there is this delinquent, but the story is bizarre, and I would like to use humor in it. I know that those are my skills, you know, I'm not using it for the shop or mostly, but of course, there is a situation with humor as well, because you have the situation. What I like about the story is the phenomenon of the delinquents and of its influence, of the influence of the previous delinquencies in our lives in the present. And that's what Martin is facing. And he was a young delinquent, he maybe did some writing. That's what got him into the reformatory, and that's what led to the sentence of him having some next years to spend in the prison after his 18th birthday. Now he's 17. And that's why he's escaping at the beginning of the story. Yeah. And I like the influence of the previous influences on our life. And I like that I think my characters, all of them, are facing kind of a struggle. They are trying to saddle their life, but they're doing that in the wrong way, because they are trying to change the past. And I don't think this is the way how to solve problems and how to start a new life.
His parents are living on the shore of some pictures and some written work from school. And on the way back to his home, he actually runs into a girl. He pushes her bicycle outside the road. And then he has to take her to the hospital. In the hospital, he realizes that he's in love with that girl, but also has to face the fact that she's a zookeeper. So he leaves her suddenly without really saying bye, really stunned in the hospital and alone also. Later on, he also his brother arrives at his parents' house. So he's invited actually to go to a place where it's actually a conservation trust where all the animals that are protected from poachers are kept. And Laura, the girl he saved from the hospital, actually works there. So he has the chance to meet her again and apologize. The thing is, their relationship is kind of doomed at this point because he's not really ready to confront his parents and leave law school. His parents are the ones who kind of push him to go into studying law. So in order to go back to his passion and be with Laura, he has to confront his parents, mainly his mom. So actually, Laura leaves him, and this is when he realizes that he has to confront his mom. After doing that, he is able to live happy with the person he loves, and also realizes that he just has to follow his passion. So, my message is, you can control your parents. But kind of but you cannot control life. So destiny will also will always find its way back to you. And yeah, in order to if you want to clean nature, you have first to clean up yourself.
I have to use some magic.
And as a business owner, her life is very stressful and busy. She's always on the phone, on the computer, and busy with the suppliers and the customers and the employees and everything. And so, therefore, the tempo is, of her life is really quickly, and you never see her smile. So one day, she is in the same tempo. She is working, busy, and serving her customers, and she's asking her next customer for his wishes. So, hello, what would you like to have? And not really even looking at him, and then she doesn't get an answer. So she looks up and she looks into blue eyes. She mainly only sees the blue eyes, really piercing and strong. And the time seems to stop. Suddenly, for the first time, there's a moment of suspension, and you see the relaxation in her face, and then her employee distracts her. It's broken, the spell is broken, and she is distracted for a moment. She looks to the side, and when she looks back, she only sees her this man, the back of this man leaving the shop. So she is startled for a moment, but then she just continues her day, and her day is continuing the same speed, everything. In the evening, she's meeting with her friends in the bar, as always. Everybody is together, they are on the phone, they are discussing, but not really. They are together, but not really. And she is a bit like a fish out of water. She is a bit distracted, looking around, and then she looks to the side, and there is a dog sitting in the bar. The dog looks like a wolf. And she catches his eyes, and his eyes are piercing blue eyes, very powerful. And again, time seems to stop, and she has a moment of relief. And she closes her eyes, and she breathes in, and she breathes out, and when she looks again to the world, he's gone. Her life continues. She goes to the nightclub with her friends. Minimal electro, like Israel and Berlin. Everybody is on their own trip individually. They are all moving on the dance floor, but not too big, not too much, not too little. They are all just one big mass of passing people. Only Elizabeth is in the middle of the dance floor, silent. She's not moving. She is, again, like a fish out of water, something she cannot find her zone, and she just leaves. That night she has a dream. The dream is she is in the forest on an opening, but on the opening there is all the furniture of the coffee shop. And she is there busy working, and there's just one customer, and the customer is the guy from the morning. He's sitting naked on one of the chairs and starts to talk to her. They engage in a conversation, but it's a bit, she is distant, she wants to get rid of him. But he is, he doesn't go away. Instead, he goes up and he goes towards her. And he slowly starts to undress her, and while he undresses her, he is asking her about her, what were her childhood dreams and wishes, and what did she actually what she actually wanted when she was a child, what she wanted from life, if she is happy now, if she feels whole. And when he asks the question, if she feels whole, she wakes up. And something happened, she realizes, she gets out of bed in her nightgown, she just takes a jacket, she goes out of the house, she goes on the bike and she drives. She drives past her coffee shop, she drives along out of the city, along the fields, and she arrives at the forest. It's the forest of her dream. And she leaves the bike, enters the forest, and slowly starts to take off her jacket. Then her nightgown, she is naked, starts to run. She starts to sweat, she starts to get dirty from the mud on the floor. And she continues running, 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 and then she sees from far away two other creatures, the dog and the man. They run towards her, and they don't stop. None of them slows down. They just run towards her. each other. So only she is left. She is whole now, and then I see her smile for the first time.
Consequences.
And
place in Moldova?
In Moldova and Romania, because the daughter was raised up in Romania and he is Russian in Moldova. Probably he struggled to find her in Romania, trying to learn her language and trying to get in touch with her. Thank you.
Change might really come if you do something. So he
gives up and starts to think for a plan just for himself. And one day he gets the idea that maybe he should explore this religious, fanatic religious part of the society he's living in. So he paints the portrait of Jesus on a tree, which is near his man. And his plan really works very well, because shortly TV station comes and does a report on it, and word starts to spread. And everybody's going crazy about this miracle that has happened there, because of course nobody knows it was him doing the portrait. So his efforts pay off. He gathers a lot of people to the village. Of course, the others profit as well of his invention, but he's the main guy who gets the benefits. And everything is fine, but until the point where the clerics decide to make it into a official miracle, to include it into the Orthodox or whatever. And so our character starts to feel like maybe this went a little bit too far, and he puts an end to it by admitting his deed. But then nobody, absolutely nobody, wants to believe him, and he just becomes an outcast. And people stick to what they believed in the first day, that miracle, and continue on like it. So this would be the storyline. Shortly. Do you have any questions, maybe?
And also thanks to everyone. thanks to everyone. was pronounced. So she rejects completely to interfere with the outside world, and she lives in this little
The boy
rejects completely to interfere with the outside world, and he wants to close himself in this dark space, which is the apartment. Basically, he doesn't interfere with anyone. He doesn't go out. He doesn't go out to play. Right?
Okay.
He's 6 years old.
Майка му адаптира, се опитва да адаптира външния свят в неговата среда и да го забавлява се колкото се може повече и повече.
So the mother tries to take the outside world in the flat and to adapt in a way to the outside world so that they can have some kind of fun inside of this dark space.
И през цялата история топката е в ръцете на момчето, че той трябва да преодолее страха си да напусне външния свят, а всъщност се оказва, че майка му трябва да го направи в миналото, за да може да продължи.
So during the in the majority of the time of the script, he was feel like the boy is the one that is in power, and he has to decide like whether they should break this isolated space. But in the end, it actually turns out that he's not the one that is decisive. He should not be the one that is decisive power, but it's the mother that needs to make that decision and to take them outside of that space. Because when you want to change your child or your child's life, you need to change yourself first.
Налага се на майката да отиде на много важна среща с него.
The mother is requested to go on a very important meeting for her.
Professional. И се изправят в големи, тя се изправя в големи си страх, че трябва да остане сам.
And she's facing her biggest fear to leave him alone at home while she's going out for the meeting. When she comes back, she's not in the apartment. She cannot find him
anymore.
And if you want to know what happens in the end, I'm going to send you the script by email. So why I want to tell the story is because parents can often get lost or too obsessed with taking care of their child and just making sure nothing happens to their kid, just to get obsessed. And nothing happens to them because they get lost in this obsession.
Когато приемаш бащата за своето дете.
I was working on researching for a documentary there, and I met this character.
educator. She really has very very authoritarian parents and was very restricted as a child. And he moved like outside of Santiago with a small town at the coast and to create like his own space and life. And he really objects like living by the rules set by the society. And he lives there with his wife and they're like she's pregnant and they're waiting like, for his first son to be born. And he starts thinking about what he wants to create or what kind of life he wishes to have for his son, and he wants to create a space, like an open-minded free space for his kid to grow up in. And he has this small house and he starts to transform it into a ship because it's very close to the sea there, like 1 kilometer from the seaside. And he starts building it, it becomes very colorful, and he starts having tours come by and he makes like play roles with them and he plays the captain, and so like the tours can explore like their inner child. Yeah, I actually have a picture of this ship house if you want to see it. As you can see, it's very tall, it's kind of fancy, like exotic in this like kind of normal area for the other people who live by renting places to the tourists or like restaurants or like something. Because it's a very popular place, because this poet Pablo Picasso there, so it attracts tourists anyway. But his neighbors, they start complaining about him because he's having this alternative lifestyle, and they're kind of envious also because he has this great place and they're like all of them are struggling to survive because tourists only come in the summertime. And they start complaining, even his neighbor, they're calling the authorities, and yeah, he doesn't, the construction of the house wasn't made by the rules and all of these things. So one day he gets a note that his house will be demolished in 10 days. And he's there with his wife, they're worrying about the future, what to do. And yeah, it's a question, should they go on with their crazy ideas, like living in a dream bubble, or maybe get a real job? Or... And one night he finds, or he has this idea to play a trick to the authorities. He actually calls the harbor administration and asks permission to set sail for his ship. And he hopes something will happen and maybe they join the game. And really there's like three maybe officers, like from the military, they arrive there in front of the ship and they submit him like this and ask permission to come aboard. And they want to make an inspection to see if everything is in order. And this is like the climax point in the story. If the captain succeeds by playing his, or by seducing these military guys into his world, and if they give him like the official permission or license plate for his house to transform into a ship. So the real world authorities that criticize this construction of the house not being right don't apply anymore. So this is basically the story. For me it's very intriguing, the mission the captain has to have this free open-minded space and invite people and kind of like reawake the inner child and the patience of the people and remind them that something else is possible, and even if there's a lot of restrictions, like by means of imagination and even playful ideas, you can create something out of it. And Are you planning to shoot the film in the actual house played by actors, or how do you imagine it practically?
Well, the location is there, and it's really nice. It has three floors, it has a slide inside, and it has these ropes you can climb up and down, you know. And the captain really is a good actor playing this madman, pirate, and captain of the ship. I don't know, I think I could make like a casting with him and see if it works or not. But at least the location would be, it would be easy to go and shoot it there. I think he would be very open to that.
Thousands, millions of people